Hello again, this is Kevin Kitchens with Once Upon a Game on Board Game Geek, and I wanted to give you a quick play turn overview of the Conflict of Heroes solo expansion. I'm set up again for the first mission. I finished one playthrough of it, and with a few errors on my part, misremembering the original rules, I probably to my advantage won the game as the Soviet player. So, in this scenario, you start out as a Soviet player. Each side has four units. The AI, the German side, those are referred to as AI in the game, in the solo game, and the player is referred to as units. You'll see that in a minute when we look at the cards. So this is the initial setup. You've got these two rifle squads here in the trees. You have a submachine gun, rifles over here. In this area, and you've got another backup rifle back here in the corner. The Germans start out surrounding the town, and this is the control point to win the game. The Germans start out with one victory point from the control. Each side will gain victory points on eliminating units, and whoever has the control of the control point. In the game, you start off with there's a mission track that you will put this token on and track through. The different cards that you'll draw will advance the mission track. In this case, there's no yellow ones. Yellow events that will be on the track would always fire. Even if you pass them, sometimes you'll advance the thing twice, but in this case, if we advance twice, we'd skip this shot. I do believe this is a typo on the mission track, because this says the event is sniper fire, you roll a die 6. And the German loses caps, but the German AI does not lose caps because they don't have a pool of caps. They have command cards, which I'll explain a little later. So treating that as Soviet, everything else seems to be correct. There are rules down here at the bottom that you can replay the mission as the Germans, and they include different cards and different action cards, I believe. So anyway, we're just going to get started here, show you how it works. The Soviets start off with the initiative and begin. We have four cap points that we can use as we want. The one difference, and I explained this in the in my initial commentary, is that in the regular game where you're playing two players, I would choose to say activate this unit, and then I would take seven action points for that unit and then spend them down one action at a time. Meaning I might move here, and then your guy might respond to that, or I might move over here, and you're dwindling down until you have no action points left. You could add caps to that to add to that. Normally it's seven. There are some different die roll mechanisms, high-low and things like that, that'll let you get a variable amount, but for the most part it's around seven, give or take. In the solo version, you do not do that. You choose a unit. You take one action, which, as in the game, is moving a hex is an action. You don't get to say, well, I'm going to move over here. You move one action. Then you determine if you spent. And how you'll do that is by drawing one of the command cards, order cards, and there's a number on the bottom that'll show you. Let's go ahead, since I've already shuffled these up, I'm just pulling out of the middle here. And what this shows you is a number. Ooh, some light on it. And that says if you've spent one or more action points on your turn, then flip the unit. He's been spent. So that is how that plays out. And you'll do that for your players, for your units, and the AI units as well. To make that determination if the unit gets spent or not. So that variability is actually really nice, because I play this guy and say, okay, well, I'm going to have him fire here. And he does that, and then his fire action was 4 points, and I flip the card and it says, well, if you spent 5 points, you're spent. So he didn't spend 5 points, he spent 4, so he's good. So my next turn, impulse, I don't have to use him. Whereas in the old game, I would have to use him. There are some alternate rules, I believe, where you can just constantly just give everybody a pool and move them around and not lose them. But if I wanted to use somebody else in the old game, I would normally have to say, okay, I'm done with him, he's spent, and then go into the next guy. In this case, I don't have to do that. I can use him for one turn, and then I can come over here and fire with this guy if I want to, and the variability of who gets spent definitely increases the strategy here, and actually gives you more play, because now there's no need for opportunity fire, because he's going to move one spot, and then I can react with one of my units. So it really, really, really plays great. I enjoy that aspect of it quite a bit. I have a limited pool of caps. There's some cards, or some of the action cards in the game will give me more caps if I need them. There's some events here that'll give me possibly some more caps. So I have a limited pool. The AI, when they draw a card, if it's at the top says it's a command card, then that's treated as if they had spent caps on it, and they don't risk the becoming spent. So, makes it a bit challenging, but after one playthrough, it didn't seem to be too big of a deal. So, we're just going to start here. Probably not going to do very well, but we will see what we can see. So, the first thing I'm going to do is I've got these guys. They're already in good cover, and I don't know that I want to act with them right now. Probably want to bring this guy closer because he's a rifle and there's nobody in range. So I'm going to take this guy and I'm going to move him one space forward. All right, and that gives him, that's one action point. So I'm going to draw my card and it says if I spent greater than four action points, greater than or equal to four, my guy activated. You ignore everything on the card when you're checking for action points. There's also a indicator on some of the cards, and this applies to the player only. That's a helmet with a check mark, and that means no matter what you spent, you're fine. So, and you can choose to toughen the game by not using those per the rules. So he moved, he's fine, and he is not spent. So now we're going to draw an AI card, and this is where it really gets good. So first thing we do is flip over the card, and the first instruction we have is advance the time track one space. We have to do that. And then we have to resolve the time trap. So that's where we got over here. And we were here, and now we're going to advance it one to sniper fire. And it says roll 1d6. So I'm going to do that. And I rolled a 6. And the 6 means minus 3 caps for the German, which I'm translating as the Soviet. And it's only for this round only. But, ouch, that hurt. That took me from 4. And I've only got 1 cap to spare this turn. So that was painful. So now that that's done, we've resolved the event on the mission track. Now we have to go over and resolve the rest of the card. So the first step is the priority orders. And this says anybody that's in close combat, first look for an AI in close combat. There are no AI in close combat, so we can skip that order. The next step, priority-wise, is look for an AI that is in short-range combat. Well, in this case, there's still nobody in short-range, so we skip that. Now we execute counteractions. Some cards have this execute counteractions option, some don't. Counteractions are defined by the mission. And here are the counteractions section of the board. I mean, of this particular mission. It says, if no unit just fired, the AI closest to a spent unit move towards. So let's resolve that. No unit just fired. My most recent unit was this guy. Took an action. Nobody fired. However, you look at all the AIs, and you find the one closest to a spent unit. I have no spent units. Units are mine. AI, in the rules, is the AI player. Kind of clear. So, since that can't happen, there is no spent unit. That cannot happen. The execute counteractions cannot happen. You go to the next order, which is now tactical. Here we have the unhit AI closest to a fresh unit that just acted. All right, I think we're going to be able to do this one. So, first step, and you read it, and this is very confusing for me at first. Read these left to right in order. Sometimes you overthink it, and I did this a lot. I was overthinking and saying, well, but if I've got this combination the reverse way, and no, read it in order. Find all your unhit AIs. All my AIs here are unhit. Closest to a fresh unit that just acted. This is the unit that just acted. He's still fresh. Okay, so if he had been spent, he would not be fresh anymore, and then this would be skipped. The unhit AI closest to him. So the closest is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, five, six. One, two, three, four, five, six. Okay, so these two are out. These two are closest. Now, there are some rules that when you're picking a unit to move, you pick the one that has the least movement expenditure. If you're using a fire order, which this is, then you pick the unit that has the highest firepower. So in this case, we have a firepower of 2 and a firepower of 3. So this is our unit that's going to act. Now, the closest to a fresh unit that just acted is only relevant to find out which unit acts. It has nothing to do, it doesn't mean that he has to fire at him. It just means that's your marker to tell you which unit to pick. So we've done that, we picked this unit. He's now going to fire, and the rule is he fires at the closest unit that he has as a target. So in that case, that would be this guy. So now we would look at his firepower. He's a 3 against a soft target, and he's not against any bonuses because he's at normal range. However, this unit has 12, plus he gets a 2 bonus for being in the woods. So now we've got a 3 going against 14. That means he needs an 11 to hit. There is a rule that if you need an 11 to hit, they won't take the fire. They won't take the shot. You move to the next order. So this is where it gets kind of interesting when you're kind of like working your way through these. Bigger firefight is going to be really interesting, but just stick it with the small one for now. So the deal is he is going to shoot there, and he's not because he needs an 11. So the next order we go, AI closest to a target. Okay. Got these guys here. Who's closest? He is still closest to a target. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 1, 2. So these guys are both here, and now this is going to be a move order on the card. Sorry. See here, the order is actually a move order. So in that case, we want to pick the one with the least movement cost, and they're both at 1 because they're mobile. So what we need to do here is just roll a die. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Got a 6, so he's going to be the one we move. And now he can move. Now he's not doing a safe move, he's doing a regular move. And there's a difference between the two, or a low risk move, I should say. So he's currently 1, 2 away. He can move, he wants to move towards the target. If he can move towards, which means decreasing his distance or keeping it the same. So if he were going to do a low risk move, he would move into cover. Okay? But he's not doing a low-risk move, he's doing a straight-up move, so he's going to actually move into engage. So we will pick one, and it's really just a choice. Roll the die again, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Got a 2. So he's going to move here. Then he gets to turn and face his enemy, but he wants to face as many enemies as possible, so he doesn't want to be in this guy's flank. So he's actually, when he moves in, he's going to come in at this angle here. And now he has a direct shot at this guy, and he's facing this guy as well. So that works out pretty good. So he's done his move, and he is done. So his movement, since he was facing this way, he moved into a clear area, and his movement was only a 1, is a 1. He spent 1 action point to move. So this card says if he used more than 3 action points, or 3 or more action points, he would be spent. He did not. So the AI turn is complete. So now we'll take another of my turns. Well, he moved right into my way. The downside is I have no firepower, or no bonus, no base firepower, excuse me, against a hard target, the SDKFZ 25251. So what I'm going to do is I can, because I'm in close range, I get a +3 anyway, facing him, so I'm hitting a 13, I got a 3, I'm going to go ahead and spend my 1 cap. I'm going to activate him to fire, and I've got a 0 plus a 3 is a 3 plus a 1. I've got a 4 base going against a 13, so I need a 9 or higher to make the hit. And I rolled a 5, so I missed. So my firepower, action points was a 3. Draw a card. If it's greater than or equal to 4, he's spent, so he is not spent. And now we go back to the AI. So, in a nutshell, this is how the game plays. Just these impulses back and forth. checking the cards. There are some cards that require you to reshuffle the deck. There are some cards that a larger firepot, you might go through the deck and then you reshuffle. So far, it's pretty cool. The one thing I was concerned about is, finding the units to act. Finding who they attack and move towards is not really as big a deal, but just got to take your time, go through the card, do it left to right, and it'll resolve pretty quickly. Once I set that in my head, it definitely went a lot smoother. There was a couple of times where it seemed like a unit was ping-ponging, where the one action moved him here and then moved him here based on that, and I guess that's just valid. So we're going to go on and keep moving with this turn. So it is now the AI's turn to act. We just tried to fire on this unit and missed. And so now we're probably in deep trouble here, depending on what the card gives us. So let's draw the AI's card. All right. Wow. First thing up, move the mission tracker two spaces. We run sniper fire, and we go 1, 2, and that takes us to box 4, which has an action, which is auto rally. As the AI action, the hit AI closest to a unit auto rallies, even if spent. These actions take place as command actions, which means they don't use points. There is a note here, however, that if something is an AI action, it replaces any order the AI would normally attempt to execute on the current order card. If it does not have that, then it's an additional action that happens, and then you resume the card. Now, this is actually kind of confusing, because the hit AI closest to a unit auto rallies. We have no hit AI. My assumption is then that this is treated as if it had been on the card right here before the priority orders, and therefore if it can't be executed, then you go on to the next one, and that's how I'm going to play it, even to my detriment. It'd be nice to go, haha, you can't get me now, but he can. So the first thing is, anything in close combat? Nothing is in close combat. Anything in short range combat? We do have this unit, short range combat. I'm in trouble. If you have a unit in short range combat, fire. So he is now going to fire on the SMG in the woods. He has a firepower of 3. He is facing my front, so he's going to have to hit a 12 plus a 2. Is a 14, plus he gets his plus 3 bonus, so it's a 6 going against a 14, which is an 8 difference, which is then is less than 11, obviously, so he is going to take the attack. So 3 plus 3 is 6 going against a 14. And the roll was a 9, so it's 15. He got a hit. So bring over the Cup of Doom, grab a token, and now since it's mine, I can look at it. It doesn't matter, obviously. So my guy's suppressed. So I'm going to put this under him. It means his firepower is weakened completely, and his cost to fire is greatly increased. If the AI has a fire marker, then a hit marker, excuse me, you draw it, you don't look, and these are pretty easy to feel without looking, but you put it under the AI, and then it's only revealed when that unit is activated to move or be a target or so on and so forth. So he'll still be on the board, it'll be revealed later. All right, so that's that was the AI's move. It was not a command card, so therefore we got to determine if he is spent. He did an attack, which was 2. It was in his firing arc, his front firing arc, so he does not take a 2 penalty for firing outside his firing arc. And so therefore he is a 2. And we will draw. If it's greater than or equal to 6, then he would be spent, and he is not spent. So the AI's turn is over. One note on this mission about this unit is he is not allowed to move onto this control area, which is a building, unless he's the only unit left. So he cannot reclaim control. If we take it, he cannot come in and take it back until he's the last unit left. So, but our mission track is moving at a pretty good clip right now. So, Let me see what we can do. Alright, so it's my turn. I can still attack if I want to. However, I am now really hurt at a negative 2. I have no more caps. I am only suppressed in terms of fire. So I think what I'm going to do is I want to get out of his way. So I will move either 1, and I'm going to do a back lateral move into this house. So it's a 1. It's a 1 for the backwards move. It's a 1 for moving into the building. So he's spent 3 points. So his 3, we draw greater than or equal to 6. He's not active. This is actually unusual. I reshuffled the deck and I'm getting a lot of non-spent draws, but the last game there was a lot of spent draws. So they're in there. It's not all greater than or equal to 5 or 6. So so now we've done. We slip over to the AI again. And this is a command order, what I was talking about. So a command order, you're still going to do it the exact same way. The only difference is the unit that acts does not have to check for being spent. So we have nothing now in close combat. We have nothing now in short range combat. We do not have a counteractions order, so we don't have to check that. Now we do the highest firepower AI farthest from a fresh hit unit. So first thing you do is find the highest firepower AI. So you look at all your AIs, you've only got 1 3, the rest are 2s. If you have multiple 3s, then all those would be eligible, you start whittling them down. So he's the highest firepower AI. Farthest from a fresh hit unit. Units are me, I only have 1 fresh hit unit. I don't really have to determine. Basically, as long as this guy's going to act, because if all these units have been hit, it wouldn't matter, because he's the highest firepower unit. That's farthest from the only one here, so he's the one that qualifies. So the rule here is fire, even at long range, and he gets to fire with +1 cap. Now his firing arc is here and here, so he's outside the firing arc. Now he's going to fire at the closest unit. So he has a shot at this guy here. And this guy is, well, this guy is actually the better target. If he can hit it, which he cannot because it passes through that hex which blocks line of sight. So this is his closest target. So we're going to resolve this as it's going to cost him 4, but it doesn't matter because it's a command order. So he can do whatever he wants. So he gets to fire, he gets to fire with his 3 firepower at this unit here, which is in a building. He's an 11. He has no penalty on his defense. So he's a 12 +1 for the building, gives him a 13 with a 3, but he gets a +1 cap, so he's actually a 4 hitting a 13, which is a 9, which means he will take the attack. So he got a 7, so he did not hit the command order, he does not activate. Here, if you notice at the bottom is one of those helmet with a check mark, that would, if that's drawn when you're checking for your spent unit, that would mean you automatically don't. Okay, so now it's back to me again. And oh, one thing I forgot is I do get an action card each round. So we're still in the first round, so I get a 1 free action, which is awesome. So I'm actually going to go ahead and use this. I should have had this earlier, but I'll take my free action to try to do a rally on this guy. And the good thing is, because it costs me no caps and no action points, it's still my action for the turn. You don't get to play this and take another action. I'll take my action, and it switches over to the AI. The plus is, I don't have to check to see if he's spent. He just gets it. And since a rally check is 5 action points, he'd be most likely spent. I'm going to take this as my free action and do the rally check. So on being suppressed, the rally check is greater than or equal to 7. I don't have any caps to add to it. And we roll, I got a 10, so he has rallied. That goes back in the cup. And awesomely, this guy is now not hit anymore, but that was my turn. So I don't even draw a card, don't even cycle through them. So we'll do another AI turn here. Alright, this is not a command card, but there's no time track, mission track advancement, so that's all good, we just skip that. Nobody's in close combat. Nobody's in short range combat. So now we go to the AI closest to the lowest defense value unit. All right, so the lowest defense value unit. All the AIs are being considered. So now which one of these AIs is closest to the lowest defense value unit? He, in his current position, is a 12 plus 1 is a 13. He, in his current position, is a 12. So that's probably going to be it. He in his current position is a 14. He in his current position is a 14. He's got the modifier for the terrain. So he is the lowest DD unit. So now, it's the AI closest to that unit. Well, it's obviously going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, this guy here. So he gets to attack again, because it's a fire order. Now, again, he does not have to fire at this unit. He can fire at this unit if he wants to. However, it is going to cost him action points. He is a 12, firing from a 3, is a 9, whereas he is a 13, firing from a 3, is a 10. So he actually has a better shot. Oh no, he doesn't have a shot at this guy because of that building. So he's actually, he has one shot here at this guy, and it is going to cost him 4 to fire. 3 going at a 13 is a 10. So we'll roll, and he's a 10 to hit. And he got exactly a 10, a 5 and a 5, so there he goes. So he is hit again. Bam! Got me. So, cut the doom, draw one, take a look. Oh, suppressed again. Alright, so he's now suppressed. However, this was not a command order, therefore he was a 2 firing. He was also outside of his firing arc, so it's a 4. I have to draw to see if he's been spent, and he has. Greater than or equal to 1 makes him spent. So we flipped him over, and now he's spent. Now we're back to me. It's my turn again. Well, he's gotten away with a lot. And he has been right for target, so I think he's going to actually, before he tries to remove that suppression, he's going to back into this hex. That is a light woods, which is on foot. There's no penalty. Moving backwards is a penalty, so he's going to move 1. And he takes a 1 penalty and moves into the light woods, so that's a 2. And he'll see if he's spent. Greater than or equal to 2, he is spent. But better here than in range of something. It's a little hard to see those hex lines on the terrain. So he's now spent. And now back and forth. Here we go again. Back to the AI. Draw a card. If AI plus units is less than or equal to 10, well, we only started out with 8, so we're definitely there. Then we advance the mission tracker 2 spaces. 1, 2. Bog down. Roll a 1d6. On a 1d4, the SDKFC 251 is immobilized till the end of the round. Then the AI attempts to execute an order. First thing we do is roll this. Is a 2. So now we have... Okay, it is immobilized. So even if he gets a command order, he cannot move. He's stuck in the mud. So he cannot move. He does have a higher... He has an improvement to his rear defense and a weakening to his front defense. But essentially, he is pretty much stuck in the mud until the end of this round, which a lot of units still left. Keeping him out of play is pretty good. But that just simply means he cannot move. He cannot... he can still fire. And he cannot rally out of that. So that's good to know. However, so we're still on this card. We enacted the mission tracker. We moved the mission tracker forward. We did the event of the mission tracker. And now we have to have it attempt another order. So this one is kind of still on hold while we're resolving this one. Very, very interesting structure here. So now we resolve this action. If the AI plus the units are less than or equal to 6, then we would advance the mission tracker. We are not. We're still at 8, so we're good there. Close combat, nothing in close combat. Short combat, nothing. If the fresh AI is less than the fresh units, Fresh AI, 1, 2, 3. Fresh units, 1, 2, 3. It's not less than, doesn't say less than or equal. If he hadn't been spent, AI would have passed. So we skip that order. AI closest to a target. Alright, so we're considering AI, all the AIs, that are fresh, because this is not a command order, this is a regular order. So we're looking for fresh AI. So AI closest to a target. He is 1, 2. He is 1, 2, 3. And he is way far away. So the one closest to a target is this guy here. So now he wants to take a low risk move towards the closest unit. Okay, in this case it's going to be the same one because we're determining who he's closest to. Now, remember I said a low risk move is closing the gap or keeping the gap the same and moving into a better situation. So I should have been shooting at him because he's been in the open and I wasn't paying any attention to that. My bad. So he's 1-2 away. If he moves here, he's still 1-2 away, but he's improved his position. It's kind of tough. This is where these dilemmas come in. Because if he moves there, now he's blocked from being shot at by this guy. However, he is getting some cover. So it's no hit from here and out in the open here. So here he gets the benefit of some cover. And he can actually adjust his angle to cover them both. So he's going to go ahead and move into here and pivot. Now he's got both of them in his sights. And that was a one move plus one moving into the building. It's 2, greater than or equal to 2, he's spent. Alright, so he's spent. We've resolved the second card. Now we finish with the original card. Again, nothing close, again, nothing short range. Fresh AI, if the fresh AI is less than fresh units, and see, order is important because now this has happened. Fresh AI. Okay, sorry about that, the video cut off. So we're just in the middle of resolving the second card. We finished the first card with this guy moving into cover, and then he was spent. So now we got to resolve the next card. And now, because he was spent, the fresh AI is less than the fresh units, 1-2 on the AI, 1-2-3 on the units, therefore the AI passes, and his turn is complete. So the game will continue like this, with me taking turns, him taking turns. One thing that's not specifically spelled out is because of the command cards, the round does not end when all the units are spent, because a command card can allow those units to act as if they had caps. So you have to go ahead and play out those cards, and then as the player, you're hoping that they get a card that's an action card or a standard order card, and therefore they can't take any actions, and then you know the turn will be over. Great game, really, really fun. I don't know how deep it gets with the multi-board maps. This is played on map 2. From the base set, just 4 units each side, very simple system, very simple setup. One thing I'll notice on this playthrough is I'm at position 6 on a 12 position mission track, which means I'm already halfway over, and it's the first turn. The last game moved very slowly. That randomness, awesome, awesome, awesome. Gonna give you a totally different play each time you play. See if I can think of anything else to close this up. When the turn's over, when the round is over, you flip everybody back, you take your caps minus any lost units you had. You shuffle the deck each new round, and you draw up a new card, and a new action card for you, and you can build those up and use them when you need them. So we'll get more later. Again, full more review is coming. Just want to show you how the gameplay works so you can understand the differences and exactly how the cards work. But pretty, pretty cool system. I said it in a comment. Even though these guys aren't named and randomly generated, I got a feeling this is gonna just really kill Ambush for me, the classic Butterfield game. Just because I can set it up, I can play it solo. The variety's there. you can kind of more focus on your guys and your actions instead of having to worry about, you know, coming up with the second side of the AI, which is what Ambush does really well. You don't get the narrative, you don't get the named guys, you don't fall in love with them and hate when they die, but this is just so far is a really, really, really awesome system, and I hope they made enough that this is going to be available in stores for a long time to come. So I'll sign off for now, and I hope you enjoyed this. Take care. Happy gaming.